Hey folks, this is Best in Slot, and in tonight's video we're going to check out Devlog number 32 from the devs of Prehistoric Kingdom. They newly renamed the devs, we'll talk about that in a second. They took a few months off, they didn't do these devlogs for the last 3 or so months, just because they were working on the IGN First stuff and the brand new trailer, working with Nigel Marvin, you know, all the good stuff. But we're back, there's some cool stuff, let's dig into it. So as per usual, we're going to kick things off with the development report. And as you can see from the left-hand side, a lot of pretty cool stuff has been essentially finished. The mini exhibits seem to be done. The environmental assets, two things we're going to see later on in this video, and the animal assets themselves. We know there are 22 dinosaurs hitting the first release of Prehistoric Kingdom, and it seems, or 22 prehistoric creatures, I should say. Paleofauna, that's the term we want to use. It seems they are built. Now they need animating and AI and stuff like that, but the foundation has been laid. If we go over here to my notes, you can see they've been busy. It was emphasized, so I thought I'd emphasize it. They've been busy. They've been hard at work despite doing the trailer and stuff like that. A new person, Digital Duck, has joined the team. Very coincidentally, I highlighted one of Digital Duck's Jurassic World Evolution mods literally yesterday on the channel. He's a very, very talented paleo artist. I think he's joining to do primarily animation work, but I could be completely misremembering that. But high five, Digital Duck. Good job, buddy. Power management has been in development. We're going to be talking about that later on in the video as well. Lots of other stuff in development. And they have renamed their studio. They're no longer the edgy Shadow Raven. They are now Blue Meridian, which is also the name of a charity that I found because I wanted to Google if Blue Meridian meant anything in particular. A meridian line is a line of longitude on a globe, but it's blue. Let's move on. So I've already talked about this a little bit, so I don't want to go into it too long. They posted a new screenshot just around Halloween last week, and it showed off the new modular lighting system. You can see a little glimpse of it here, 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 and lots of other places. Basically, it means you'll be able to put down lights and customize their colors. They've also said you'll be able to choose what time of day they'll come on. It was basically the lights will automatically turn off in daytime and come on at nighttime, but if you wanted to use them in daytime, there is a setting to enable you to do that as well. I've also highlighted that it's very spooky. If you want an in-depth breakdown of this specific screenshot with our Torvosaurus here, check out my video from earlier last week. Let's move on to the truly new stuff, and that is the decorative garden stuff. And the first part of that is the mulch. You can't just have your flowers sitting there on the concrete, that would look silly. So instead we're going to have our decorative mulch, and you can see it comes in many myriad shapes, so you can make yourself your little plant pots, your little gardens and stuff like that. It's also modular in a really cool way. You can see here that this one here has been squished down, made into a suppository of some form, and there is no texture squish. I still don't know how they've done this, but this is a consistent thing with Prehistoric Kingdom, giving you the ability to resize things and stretch things and still maintain the quality of the original texture. But there's not much point in that mulch if you can't then put flowers in it. So there we go, there's a nice little example of a custom made little decorative plant planter that they've built. Now these are decorative only, as it says here. These won't impact your dinosaur's foliage needs. So some plants will be foliage plants and some plants will be decorative only, like these ones right here. And you can see the mulch beneath it. So you're gonna lay your mulch with rocks and flowers and do some decorating, make your park look pretty. It's a zoo. Go wild with it. Of course, if the humans are going to get new plants, the dinosaurs deserve them as well. And therefore, we have a new biome, the wetlands biome, a very swampy, moist biome, the way we like it. Now, this one isn't quite 100% done. There are a few more trees to be designed for it, but it's still got the cypress at the moment. It's got lily pads, it's got bulrushes, or bulrushes of some description. And it looks pretty great. Yeah, there you go. Big old lily pads. These are Amazonian ones, I believe, as Planet Zoo has hopefully taught me. And yeah, it's just a really cool looking biome, very suitable for your maybe semi-aquatic dinosaurs. You could see a Suchomimus stalking through that environment. Always been a big fan of swampy biomes and stuff like that. I'm excited to see this with some slightly stronger lighting. It's a little bit washed out here. Maybe a little bit darker at night, a little bit spookier, because God knows everything has to be spooky all the time. But yeah, another great looking biome. I'm excited to see what it's like when it's fully done. I think we're getting a full environmental overview pretty soon when they are 100% finished, and that could be in the next devlog, so keep an eye out for that. Now, one of the most surprisingly entertaining parts of this whole devlog is the new texture blending system that they're showcasing, and this is height-based texture blending. So I'm going to try to explain what that is in very layman terms, which are the only terms I understand it in anyway. basically. So a lot of you will have played older games or lower quality games or games that have to run on old PCs, and they'll look like this. You'll have textures, and let's say you're here, this is you, and you're running along, you enter a new area, and instead of the textures blending in naturally and seamlessly, they'll just fade into one another. Now this is a pretty extreme example, but it happens all the time in video games. Go play something like MMORPGs in particular, we'll have this kind of thing a lot. If we head back over here, you can see this looks much, much more natural. You can imagine this sort of ground texture here, maybe extending all the way over there and then off into the distance. Likewise over here on the right hand side, this stone here could extend all the way down here. You know, that could be the way the stone and the snow blend together. It looks really, really good. I especially like this sort of dried, beachy looking mud we've got here second along. Really a big fan of that. I can imagine those little, I can't even remember what they're called. You know the little mollusks on the beach and they make like little blobs with a hole in? You know what I mean? Does anyone know what I mean? It's like that and then there'll be a little hole and it sits in there. They're like funnel shaped. Does anyone know what I mean? Am I talking nonsense? Probably. Anyway, so this is height-based texture blending. So if you imagine, let's take this texture on the right-hand side. No, the left. This is a good example. So you can see by looking at this that there's shadow and light and stuff like that. And this bit here, for example, is quite a lot higher than the areas around it. You can see how the mud has been raised up. The textures have maps on them, essentially, that dictate which part of the texture is higher and which part is lower. They're given a height. Now, if you put two of those textures together, the higher textures are going to overlap over the top of the lower textures. And that's what's going on over here on the right-hand side, for example. The height values of these textures, these bits of rock here, is higher than the snow underneath, but the snow is higher than the bottom of the rock. So essentially, the rock lays over the top of the snow, and the two textures get blended together in a really natural looking, really cool looking way. It's a really, really cool system. I'm sure it takes a lot of work, but it creates immensely natural looking, realistic looking environments, and yeah, it's oddly exciting to me, this page right here. Another image I briefly showed you during the Torvosaurus Halloween screenshot expose is the industrial power station, a big ol' chunk of a power station gonna just charge and power up a large swathe of your park. They do describe it as powering up your park and being part of the power grid. We also saw what looked to be, if we nip back to our Torvo actually, there you go, look at that pro stuff here. You can see over here, that is definitely a wind turbine. So I posited in the last video that the idea is you'll have a major power thing, but maybe you want to supplement smaller areas that have a required, like an immense power need or something like that, maybe around exhibits for backup power. You know, maybe your industrial power station goes down, but at least you can still keep your electric fences charged using a backup wind supply, something like that. I don't quite know how it's going to work yet, but it seems you're going to be balancing big chunky power stations and smaller, moderately less chunky power stations. Now for some of the more, even more exciting stuff. One of my favourite parts of the trailer, I think the part of the trailer other than Nigel himself that kind of blew people away, was the introduction of the mini aviaries. A very well kept secret, it must be said. Now these are going to be buildings that you just place down in your zoo, like so, I should call it a zoo, really, and you're going to populate it with various different small animals. I've gone ahead and blown up the bits on the right. We get a little bit like the blah 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 blah. We can get a little bit better look at those. We can see here what looks to be a staff entrance over there. This is lovely. And then we have a do not feed the animals sign saying keep fingers and hands away from the cage. Very exciting. And what is going to populate those mini exhibits, mini aviaries? Well, if you didn't see it last time, the Microraptor, of course. And we did get a little bit of bonus information about those aviaries. So we now know the aviaries are going to be customizable. This is all from the Devlog. And these are the four things, at least so far, you're going to be customizing. So the temperature, certain animals are going to require certain heats. Materials, is that, so example here, we can see the sort of stony metal, I don't know what it's meant to be, it's metal or a stone, but maybe you could change that to a wood or something like that. And the lighting, whether that's changing and individually placing lights or changing the color of them, the intensity of them, and stuff like that. The exciting one though is this one right here. I'll just, there you go. It's not even a good arrow. Wait, bear with me, professional video. There you go, environmental preset. Now, I'm not really sure what to take from that and what that could mean, other than, again, I really hate to harp on Planet Zoo when I do these videos, but it is fairly comparable to their mini habitats, although a little bit cooler, let's be honest. But you can see here this is a tropical environment. You know, it's warm, it's got palm trees, it's got, you know, colourful foliage. Environmental preset to me sounds like you'd have tropical and you'd have, you know, cold. Alpine, probably not cold, or desert, or something like that. It sounds like a preset environment that you would flip between depending on the needs of your animal. So that suggests we're going to have multiple different environments. We're not just going to, and I could be wrong here, I'm not going to pretend otherwise, but it could be more than just this tropical one that we then customize, but it could be entirely different environments to suit the different miniature animals. We don't know what animals we're going to get. We only know about the Microraptor, but in the final game, we can assume we're going to have at least a few of them. So very potentially exciting. Gonna keep an eye on that. Hopefully we get some more information about the mini aviaries pretty soon. Now, in terms of new information in the devlog, that's about it. It finished off with a bit of a recap based on the live stream and all that kind of jazz and the trailer, stuff we've already talked about fairly extensively on the channel. So this is one of the images from that trailer, and it's just talking about the launch roster. So as you can see, we're going to have 22 dinosaurs, 22 animals, I should say, 19 dinosaurs, maybe 18, we'll see, we'll talk about that in a second. 22 animals at launch. It's going to include the mini exhibit with the Microraptor, maybe something else. It's going to have animal animations and sounds, and of course there's two of the dinosaurs. The first two we found out were coming along, then Pseudoceratops and Dinochirus. If you go on the Prehistoric Kingdom website, they've slowly been revealing which dinosaurs are going to make it into that 22 animal roster. Which animals? I've got to stop saying dinosaurs. Now, we know 17 dinosaurs are going to make it into that release roster, and we know 7 of them so far. So again, we have the Dinochirus and the Pseudoceratops, but we also have Lambeosaurus, Styracosaurus, Torvosaurus, Triceratops, and Tyrannosaurus. Still 10 more to be revealed, unsure what they are. When the entire roster has been shown, of course I'll do a video on that, we'll go through each animal one by one. But very exciting, slowly but surely, these little blobs are going to get filled in, and we're going to find out, just in case you somehow can't see them, we'll find out what's on the roster. But of course it's not just dinosaurs, that's 17 out of 22. We also have 3 mammals, the Coelodonta, Mammuthus, and Smilodon. We've already seen all 3 of those in the trailers and stuff like that, and all 3 of those are going to make it into that 22 animal roster. But there's 2 left, and you're there at home thinking, but best in slot, what are those last 2? Well, I'm going to show you folks, I'm going to bloody show you, there you go. So there's going to be 2 mini exhibit animals. Of course, we've already seen the Microraptor. We haven't seen what this cheeky... I really can't draw arrows, can I? We haven't seen what this cheeky little blighter is. Could it be an animal that might showcase that variation in the environment that we talked about earlier on in the video? These look like pointed sperms. I don't know. Probably not. I'd imagine for the initial release, you'd rather have one very well-made environment that suits both animals rather than mixing and matching already. But we'll have to wait and see. This is the animal I am most excited to see, other than one dinosaur. So that's it, folks. That's all the new information. That's all the information, full stop, in the devlog. Exciting stuff. Height-based terrain maps, environmentally customizable, maybe mini exhibits, a look at the final roster. We're halfway through it at the moment. I think we might just do a video every time a new creature gets announced, to be honest. Yeah, there's some new wetlands biome, lots of exciting power station, lots of exciting new stuff on the way. Justice for Uti, Uteranus, of course, should be one of the 17 dinosaurs making it into the roster. It has been upgraded. I'll give the Prehistoric Kingdom devs this. They did upgrade its star rating. I believe it's now 3 stars instead of 2. How it was ever 2 is just utterly ridiculous, frankly. Just, this is my expert drawing, by the way. This is also, if the PK devs are watching this, this is my application to join the art team for the game. Thanks. So, hashtag justice for UT. Let's get it trending. Either way, folks, either way. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you again to the PK devs for these devlogs. They must be quite a lot of work, but it's really cool to have developers. I really can't speak today, which is bad considering what my job is. Developers who are open about what they're working on and what the future holds and stuff like that. I really, really appreciate that level of communication. Very, very excited. I will update you as soon as we know any of the extra animals. 11 more to go until we get the full release or initial release roster. Of course, there's going to be upwards of 50 animals in the final game. This is just for initial release. I will let you know all about that right here on the channel. We'll be back with next month's Devlog. Next month, I assume. Thank you so much for joining me. Please do hit the like button if you enjoy and appreciate these videos, and indeed, Deuteranus. I will link the Devlog down below if you want to check it out for yourselves. Do go do that. Give them some love. Remember to wishlist Prehistoric Kingdom on Steam. You can do that right now. Go do it right now. And I'll see you lovely folks next time. Cheers. Much love, as always. Bye-bye. We'll be right back.